breaking through the silence with glory in the highest, the hope of all creation resting in his mother's arms. A song on the horizon, ringing through the heavens, the long-awaited Savior come to set the captives free. Come to set the captives free. Come set us free.
Unspoken, come, taste of his perfect love. what your God has done. Christ is born. Christ is born. Christ is born for you. He's the Lamb who was given. So come, though you have nothing, come. He is the offering, come. See what your God has done. Christ is born.
Well, good morning and welcome to Calvary Baptist Church. We are so glad that you are here today. Anyone have an awesome and amazing and a wonderful week? A couple of you. The rest of you, I will pray for you. Hey, there is something to celebrate today, and that is the birth of Jesus Christ. And man, I don't know about you, but I love coming in this place and being able to worship, to sing with each other, to encourage one another, to learn God's word together, because I believe that what happens in here can make a difference out there and can make a difference in here. And it all starts with Jesus Christ. And most of you know John 3:16. We started singing a song last week out of John 3:16, and we're going to sing it again today, so if you would stand with us.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
For God so loved the world.
For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well, I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved the world.
God, praise God.
Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Praise Him.
Praise Him, praise Him, for the wonders of His love. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, praise Him, for the wonders of His love. His amazing love, for God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save. For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated, now it is well, I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, for God so loved the world. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Well, welcome to Calvary Baptist Church. I know I say this every week, but regardless of where you're coming from this week, it is always a great day to be with you here on Sunday mornings to worship the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And especially during this season, as we remember that the Son of God, who has existed throughout eternity, who was with the Father, who was the one through the world that was created through, came down from heaven and took on flesh and joined us in this world so that we could be saved. He is the one we worship this morning. He is the reason we are here today, and He is the one whose name we will praise and worship today and as we leave here this morning. And so if you're with us this morning, we just want to say thank you for joining us. If this is your first time with us, be sure to fill out that blue card on the seat in front of you. You can drop that in the offering bucket as it's coming by, or you can come and talk to one of us after the service, and we would love to talk with you, connect with you, say thank you for joining us this week. And we've got a special gift just to say thank you for coming and joining us this Sunday. And so we're going to continue to worship the name of Jesus this morning. But before we do, would you join me in a word of prayer? Father, we thank You that even though we are all sinners, even though from the moment we came to this earth, we were enemies of You, we chose to follow after sin rather than follow You. Father, we thank You that You have so loved the world that You sent Your one and only Son to come and live the life we couldn't live, die the death we deserved, and rise 3 days later. And we know that now He's been risen, He has been ascended, He is seated at Your right hand, and He has been given all authority. We don't have that authority, Lord, You do. And so may we give it all to You today. May You be pleased, may You be honored, may You be glorified as we worship You today. As John the Baptist said, Lord, may we decrease so that You would increase, Lord. Jesus, it is all about You today. We love You, and it is in Your mighty and powerful and precious name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. May you stand back up, please.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who shakes?
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Oh, you know this one. This is Amazing Grace.
This is Amazing Grace. This is unfailing love.
then you would take my place, then you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Yeah. Who brings our chaos back into order?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. The nations with truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
All singing out, this is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. You would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
You know, this time of year we normally sing a Christmas song or two, and this song was just put on my heart. It's a new hymn, and there's just something about it because it just doesn't just tell the story of the birth of Jesus Christ, but the story tells the birth, the life, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and even the impact Jesus had on the world. And we are that impact. The church is that impact. The transformed life is that impact. And that's why we praise God today. That's why we praise the Son. That's why we praise the Holy Spirit, because He is the one who rescued us from our sins. So would you sing this new song with us? In the darkness we were waiting.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill.
fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the Word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
That's why we praise the Father.
Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. The kingdom come, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation. You did not despise the cross, for even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake, you died.
Praise the Father.
Father, we come to you today just praising you, Father, for who you are. Father, you've created us, you've made us, you breathed life into us, Father, and then you've watched us fall. But Father, you were so merciful, so loving that you provided a way that you sent your Son to die for our sins. Lord, Father, we just pray that today you will help us to see that more closely, that we will find out more what that means to us, Father, and that we can live for you in a better way. Lord, we love you. We love this church, Father. I pray that as we go into the service that you would speak words to us that we could hear, that would speak us to, that would just help us be more like you. And it's in your Son's precious name that we pray. Amen.
three more chapters to the right. If not, it is page 1225 in my Bible. So if you've got the same exact Bible as mine, you can turn to 1225. Anyone have the same Bible as mine? Do you? No. I was like, whoa, that is crazy. Anyways, hey, we are in a new season, a new holiday season. And I call it the season of grace because I believe that's what Christmas is all about. I believe it is all about grace. Grace is unmerited, unearned favor. God's kindness when you and I did not deserve it. We talked about last week that grace is relational, and it can only be relational when someone is in debt and somebody is holding the debt, and this person chooses to forgive the debt of this person. Not because this person is great enough or amazing enough or smart enough or good looking enough. Doesn't matter what your job is, what you drive, what your home is, who your grandma was. It is simply because God showed favor upon you. That is grace. But we do have a problem with grace is because even though we sing the song Amazing Grace, the reality is grace has become so commonplace in our lives. We go to church, we sing the songs, we hear the same stories, we do the same things year in and year out. And talked about last week, it's almost like we're on autopilot. It's like you're driving home from work, you get home, and you're like, wow, how did I get here? So, like, I just blacked out for the 10-minute, 15-minute drive. I just got on autopilot, and sometimes we do that with the church and religion and Christianity and Jesus and grace. And the reality is in this series, in the month of December, what I want you to know, and not just know, but I want you to experience grace. Because I believe when you experience grace, it radically transforms your life. The fact is, you and I both need help. If we are honest this morning, we look at our world and we look at, you don't even have to look at the news to know something's wrong, right? You can look at your own family, you can look at your own thoughts and your own life, and you know something's not right here. There's brokenness and hurt. No matter how many good decisions I try to make, no matter how hard I try to make things go right, something still goes wrong, and we need a Savior to save us from ourselves. We need a Savior to save us from our sin. We need a Savior to save us from this world. And that's the Christmas story we talked about last week in John chapter 1, that God Himself came down in human form. That He, John goes, I don't know how to describe it. I don't know how to explain it. The closest thing I can explain it to is like there's this dark room, and all of a sudden this light shone in the room and overcame the darkness. That the light had victory over everything. The reality is, John says, when that light came, when Jesus came as a baby, He brought something. Don't you love gifts? I don't know if anybody have ever said, I don't like gifts. Anyone like that? Want to just admit it right now? You Scrooge, you bah humbug. Everybody loves gifts. Even if it's a bad gift, you know that you can exchange it at the store and get a good gift. So you like gifts. Well, here's the story. At Jesus' birth, He brought us a gift. He brought us something, not just salvation, but He brought with Himself grace in truth. He didn't just have a balance of both, because sometimes in a balance you have one more or the other. In some moments you're more truthful, in some moments you're more gracious. But no, Jesus was full of grace and full of truth all the time, and it made a difference in our world. See, I talked about last week that He called sin sin. He called the sinner the sinner. That's the truth. That's the harsh reality of it. But the grace part of it is that then He went and laid down His life and died on the cross for that sin. Grace and truth. And in this season of the chaos and the hectic moments and the politics and the shopping and the family events and the calendar, so easy to lose sight of grace in this moment. But grace is amazing. It is irresistible. It is compelling. But if you miss grace, you miss everything. And so what I want to do today is take another familiar story that you already know, and you probably could tell it to me better than I could tell it to you. But I want you to get something today that I have overlooked for years and years reading this story. I want you to see the grace upon grace, the fullness of grace that God gives to us. So would you bow your heads and close your eyes as we start? I would just like for you in just a moment, maybe you haven't had any time just to take a breath, to take a pause this week. What I would like you to do is just where you are, just pray to God and ask Him that He would speak to you today and that He would reveal His grace to you. Just a quick prayer. And then when you're done with that, if you don't mind, pray for me as I speak His word today, that it would come out clearly, it would make sense, and it would be compelling. Well, dear Lord, we come to you today, and I pray that you would pour out your grace upon us today, not because we deserve it, but because you are good. God, we love you so much, even though we were yet so undeserving. You didn't come into the world to condemn us, but that through your Son, that we might, whoever believe on Him, should have everlasting life. God, I pray that grace, we may never lose sight of that. Would you speak through me in the next few minutes to tell a story that is all too familiar? But may you show us your grace and truth. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you've got your Bibles, John chapter 4, we're going to start in verse 3. Jesus needed to go through Samaria. And so he came to the city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied, he was tired, he was exhausted. That's what I love about Jesus, is that he was fully God, but he was also fully man. He got tired, he got worn. Anyone this morning just want to admit that you're just tired this morning? You're just a little worn out, a little exhausted. You're in good company, because Jesus gets a little worn out in this body on earth from his journey. And so he's sitting by this well, and it was about the sixth hour, which is about noon, about 12 p.m. A woman of Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said, "Give to me a drink." Pause right there real quick. It's really interesting that Jesus said he needed to go through Samaria, which is a really weird way to put it. Because you know the story better than I do, that Jews don't like Samaritans. And Jews didn't want to go through Samaria because they'd have to interact with or see or be around Samaritans. They didn't like them. In fact, they stayed away. In fact, going through Samaria was the quickest route, and yet they would go the furthest possible route around Samaria to make sure they didn't see him, run into him. It's like when you go to the grocery store and you see that person that you don't want to see. You know what I'm talking about. Or you go to Walmart and you're shopping and you got your cart, and all of a sudden you see that person and you're like, you freeze and you're like, what am I going to do? And all of a sudden you kind of duck behind like another aisle and you're kind of waiting there hoping they don't see you. And you're kind of going the long way around just to get where you need to go. And that's what Jesus is doing. That's what Jews would do during this time. And you would go all the way out of your way. So when Jesus said, "I need to go through Samaria, the disciples were like, "What?" Jesus, again, I know you're Jesus. I know you know all things, but did you know we don't hang out with them? Right? We go the long way around. And I think it's interesting that Jesus said he needed to go. He wasn't forced to go. He didn't have to go against his will. And I can think that the disciples think, nobody needs to go through Samaria. You're crazy, Jesus. You got a little hot from the sun. Nobody needs to go. It's like if a man said, I needed to go to the Hallmark store on Black Friday, and I needed to wait in line for 6 hours just to get in the Hallmark store to get some precious moments. Do they still make precious moments? The little figurine? If a man told me that, I knew he was lying, or his wife made him go. You know what I mean? And so, Jesus, you don't need to go, and yet he says he wanted to go. It's almost like before the creation of the world, Jesus wrote on his appointment book, on his calendar, and said, this day, this time, at this place, I need to go to Samaria to meet a woman. You see, that's just like Jesus, though. That's just like grace, that it chases you down. It pursues you. You can try to run and hide. You can try to go about your business. And all the while you're trying to outrun God and Jesus and grace and love, you are completely unaware that God is conspiring for your good and for your grace. Sometimes we get so busy in our lives and we think we're just going about our business, going about our day. We got this calendar and this event to make, and all of a sudden you have no clue that Jesus is working behind the scenes, conspiring for your good and for your grace. In fact, I believe some of you are here today by appointment only, and you don't even know it, but God brought you here today so that you could meet him and it could experience his grace today. Verse 7, a woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, give me a drink, for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. And this woman of Samaria said to him, how is it that you, being a Jew, remember they didn't like each other, how are you talking to me? How are you asking a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? If you didn't know, you're not supposed to be here. You're not supposed to talk to me. You're not supposed to ask anything of me. I don't like you. You don't like me. For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. It's interesting. I'm not an expert really about anything, but I do know this. If you want to go, if you got a time and a place to meet, you don't normally just go out in the middle of a field and hope and wait somebody comes to you. You make the appointment, you go to a coffee shop, you go to a busy place, you go to Walmart, and you wait for that person to show up. But Jesus is waiting. If you wanted to meet somebody at a well, you wouldn't go at noon. You would go in the morning when everybody went, because it wasn't hot and it was easy to get to, and you went with groups to help each other out. And so, Jesus, if you got an appointment at this well, you came at the wrong time. You got to go in the morning or you got to go in the evening. But he knew who he was looking for, and she shows up right on time. And you know the story. She's got a bad reputation. She's got a rough past. And this woman, she's tired of the rumors. She's tired of the gossip. She's avoiding people, and people avoid her. And so she goes at the hottest part of the day. And what's worse is now, and not only is she trying to avoid people, this Jew who she doesn't even like and she's trying to avoid ask her for water. And in that moment, she's like, I don't want to deal with this. I don't want to have this conversation. I don't want to talk to you. I don't like you. I don't need you. He looks like a religious man. A religious man would be caught dead talking to her. And she knows what's coming. The religious man is going to shame me. He's going to guilt me. And he's probably going to hurt me. The reality is, in this moment, I think a lot of people feel that way. I think a lot of people assume Jesus doesn't want them. A lot of people assume that Jesus doesn't love them. A lot of people assume that Jesus wants nothing to do with them. And so what do? Before we can get hurt, we build up a wall and we reject him before he can reject us. You tracking with me? And so the reality is, we think Jesus won't want us until we clean up our lives. But the reality is, we stink at cleaning up our lives, and so we think Jesus wants nothing to do with us. Well, I got news for you, Jesus. I want nothing to do with you. But that's not grace, and that's not Jesus. The reality is, most of you, it's not that you don't want grace. You think grace doesn't want you. So you reject first and you build that wall up. You don't allow yourself to become vulnerable. But Jesus goes out of his way to meet this woman, talk to this woman, because that's what grace does. And I got news for you. If you're willing to meet with Jesus, he's willing to meet with you. Y'all need to say amen a little bit louder for those people in the back, because I'm telling you, that's good news. If you're willing to meet with Jesus, he's willing to meet with you. Jesus went out of his way. You need to know today that your mistakes aren't greater than God's grace. Your situation isn't greater than God's grace. Your failed marriage isn't greater than God's grace. Your sins and failures aren't greater than God's grace. Your diagnosis is not greater than God's grace. Your situation is not greater than God's grace. God has not given up on you, and he is willing to meet you where you are. Verse 10, Jesus answered her and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman is so confused. Track this. Jesus said, "Can I have a drink of water?" And she says, "Why are you talking to me?" And he says, "If you knew how I was, you would have asked me for water." What's your response to that? You crazy. Right? You asked me for water, and now you're telling me you have water, and I should ask you for what? What's happening here, man? The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with. This well is pretty deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than your father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock?" And she's so confused, but he is setting her up. She's so confused, but she's playing right into his hands. And she's probably thinking, "You crazy, the heat got to you. You're a little bit out there," and now she's kind of getting a little bit nervous. I remember in college, I was at a store at JCPenney's, and I was shopping, and I was walking around, and all of a sudden I got this phone call from a number I didn't know, and so I didn't answer it. And they kept calling and calling and calling. And so I finally answered it. And they said, "I know what you're doing." And I was like, "Who is this?" I just thought it was a prank, right? And so I hung up, and they kept calling and calling. So I answered, and they said, "I know what you're wearing." And I was like, "That's a little creepy, all right?" And so they start to tell me, I don't remember what I had on, like a green shirt or whatever, and pants. And I was like, okay, this is a little creepy, a little too familiar, a little bit too uncomfortable. Maybe my roommate put somebody up. Maybe my roommate saw me put my clothes on. He was just going to mess with me throughout the day. And I was like, all right, this is too uncomfortable. And they went on to say, "You're in the jeans section, in the men's section at JCPenney's." And and you start like looking around. You're like, what in the world? I just started walking quickly, right, to the front, because this is, and then I hear laughing in the background, and it's like my friend used his friend's phone to call me, and it was just this weird, uncomfortable, like, I don't understand what is happening. I feel like I need to get away as quickly as possible. This is a little bit too close to my comfort. This woman, it's a little too close for her comfort. How do you know me? Why are you talking to me? Why are you talking to me like you know me? And you're talking in riddles, and man, I don't know you. I just wanted to come get water. I wanted to go about my business. I just want to go back. And then it gets worse. It gets more uncomfortable. In verse 13, Jesus said to her, "Whoever drinks this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst, but the water I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life." And the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw." And I don't know if you can sense it, but in the Greek there's some sarcasm. Okay, if you really got everlasting water, go ahead and give it to me. But that guy doesn't know what he's talking about. And there's some sarcasm because she doesn't understand the metaphor that he's offering: eternal life, rest for her soul, grace for her brokenness, kindness for her weariness. You see, this woman has had a bad luck of run with guys. Guys who would promise her the world and would never come through. Guys who would build her up and use her for what they wanted and then discard her. She's had enough men promising her the world and not coming through. So she's skeptical that somebody can promise her something and that he can actually deliver. But Jesus is building her up for this punchline because Jesus can deliver what he's offering her. Jesus can bring grace and mercy and kindness and love. He can bring everlasting life to her situation. And he's about to show her his omniscience, that he's all-knowing. He knows her intimately even when she doesn't know who he is. I don't know if you know this today, but God knows everything about you, not just who you are, but what you are and what you think about. He knows the hairs on your head, and he cares about you intimately. Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come here." Here's the punchline. The woman answered, said, I've got no husband. You don't know what you're talking crazy again. Jesus said to her, "You have well said, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now live with is not your husband." Yeah, you're telling the truth. Here's the uncomfortable truth, whether you like it or I like it or not. Jesus is truth, and he tells us the truth. Jesus is done with metaphors because she's not getting it. So finally, he just comes out with the harsh reality. And if that was me, if that was you, we would probably respond like something like this: "You don't know me. You don't know what I've been through. You don't know what I've gone through. You don't know what I had to deal with. I'm just trying to make it day by day. You don't know me, man." The fact that Jesus knows everything can be a scary thing or can be a comfortable thing. It can be the best thing that ever happened to you or the worst thing that could ever happen to you. And he knows you, and not just who you are, but also your sin, the thing that is keeping you from grace. And he calls her on it. I want you to get this today. Jesus chose Judas to follow him, even though he knew Judas would betray him. Are you tracking with me? That's grace. The truth is, Judas was going to probably do the worst thing possible. And even in that moment, Jesus still loved him enough to call him to him and to ask him to follow him. You see, Jesus never pretends that sin is okay. Please hear me today. Jesus never pretends that sin is okay. Jesus never explains sin away. Jesus never is saying, "Oh, it's okay, honey. It's okay. You just go on right around sinning and you come worship at church on Sunday and sing your songs and it's all gonna..." No, he calls you on it. And if he's not calling you on it, we got a problem. Because God's not okay with sin. The reality is that sin, the thing she thought was going to satisfy her, would never satisfy her. It's like the old country song. She's looking for love in all the what? She's looking for love in all the wrong places, because those things will never satisfy her. But if she could find grace, if she could find grace, that might just do it. But to find grace, you have to stop hiding your sin and your shame. And that's hard. That's hard, because if it was up to me, I would make it easier. But to get grace, you got to first face truth. And Jesus calls her on her sin, the thing that she is ashamed of, her guilt. And it seems harsh, but the reality is you will never experience grace until you first own up to the truth. And so I wonder this morning, if Jesus was having this conversation with you, and he was looking in your eyes, what's the truth that Jesus would call you on? Your short temper keeps everybody on edge around you, and it's causing bitterness in relationships to you until you own up to that bitterness and that anger. You'll never find grace. Your drinking has got out of control, and it's affecting more people than you could have ever imagined. And until you own up to that truth, you will never find grace. You're going into debt to make yourself feel better, but that well will never satisfy you. You are sacrificing your future. The stuff that you're watching on your computer or your phone is killing your intimacy and your marriage. Your hypocritical lifestyle is leading people away from me. Your judgmental attitude toward your prodigal kids is pushing somebody further away. Here's the deal. I don't know your truth, because I've got my own truth that I got to deal with. But I do know this fact. Jesus knows your truth, and he's calling you on it today. And I know this. You will never find grace until you own up to your truth. It's interesting that in the worst possible moment, in the this is a little too uncomfortable, a little too personal, she's going to deflect just like we deflect. Right? When Jesus is in front of us calling us on our sin, what we do is we turn to religion and we come up with some great theological debate to deflect, because I'll be honest, it's a little quiet in this room today. And you can hear a pin drop. And we say, well, what about God's, you know, is God so powerful that he could create a rock that he couldn't lift? I mean, just crazy stuff. And that's what she's going to do in verse 19. The woman said to Sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. You're a religious guy. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, and Jews say, in Jerusalem is the place where you ought to worship, right? She turns a religious debate that no one will be able to figure out. They've been debating where we should worship for hundreds of years. I'm going to get out of this as soon as I can. And Jesus said to her, believe me, the hour is coming where you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship because you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming now when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And the Father is seeking those to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in truth and spirit. What he says is, I'm going to end this debate so we can get back to the personal relationship. Because Jesus is far more concerned about a relationship with you than religion. I'm going to say that one more time. I'm going to hope that you say amen. God is far more concerned about a relationship with you than religion. I remember this 1 hour lecture that I had in Bible college. You want to know what Bible college is like? Somebody brought up the debate, Who would win on a baseball field? You ready for this? Who would win on a baseball field? A team full of Supermans or a team full of Jesuses? And we debated that for an hour. An endless theological debate that gets us nowhere, and who cares? I kind of tell that as a joke, but the reality is it happens all the time, because I remember talking about the gospel with a woman. I was talking to her. We started talking about sin, and she interrupted me. And she said, "What about the elephants in Africa?" Okay, God loves you. You got sin. He died for you. What about the, huh? She said, "Yeah, the elephants in Africa, they're dying. What if, you know, what does God think about that?" The reality is, she got a little too personal for her. She thought when she was going to be confronted with Jesus Christ that he would condemn her. So rather than him reject her, she rejected him and turned it, deflected to religion before she could even hear the good news of grace. And I love this because she, the woman at the well, has been outrunning truth, outrunning God, and never getting grace. She talks about religion, but she never receives a relationship. And she's done. She's done with the conversation. How can I get out of here as fast as possible? Good debate. I'll see you later. She's backing away. And then this happens in verse 25. As she's backing away, she said to him, "Yeah, I know the Messiah's coming. He's called the Christ. When he gets here, he's going to explain it all to us. I'll see you later. Nice knowing you. We'll figure it out later on down the road." It's all built up, this whole story, for this moment. Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." That's me. I'm the Messiah. And I came out of love, not to condemn the world, but to save the world. I came to bring truth. Yes, there is truth. Yes, you are broken. Yes, you are hurt. Yes, you are sick. Yes, you are in need. But I also came to bring you grace. If you could hang out for just two more seconds, woman at the well, I'm telling you, there's grace coming to you like you never experienced before, because I am the Messiah. I'm the Savior. I'm the one who came to rescue you. I came to pursue you. I love you, and I will die for you, because that is who Jesus is. That is who God is. That is what grace is. And I love this. The only time in Scripture, the only time in the Gospels that Jesus, without veiled language, without a metaphor, the only time that Jesus reveals that he is the Messiah is to a messed up, broken woman. He didn't go to the temple and he didn't proclaim it to the mountaintops. We talk about go tell it on the mountain. Jesus didn't go tell it on the mountain. Jesus didn't go tell it to the religious people. He didn't tell it to the pastors. He didn't tell it to the disciples. He chose this woman at the well who had a broken past with five failed marriages, and she was living in sin with a guy, and he comes to her and he says, "I love you. I came for you. I'm offering grace. Yes, there is truth, but in truth, I'm bringing you grace and freedom. I love you." I love that story. I love it because you can spend your whole life trying to outrun God, but I got news to you. You think you're outrunning God because God is coming to collect what he owes, but I'm telling you, he's chasing you down not to collect what the debt that you owe. He's coming to give you something that you don't deserve and wipe out your debt. That's grace. That's Christmas. I got to wrap up. I still got like 5 pages of notes. I remember in Bible college, and I was dealing with some personal struggles. I was living a lie. I was in Bible college. I said I wanted to be a pastor, and yet I felt like I didn't even have a relationship with God at times. And so I put on the mask, I put on the suit, and I went to Bible college, and I did all the right things, said the right things. I went to church. I played the religious games, but it got too heavy a burden to bear. And so I just kept pushing it down. Every time it bubbled to the surface, I push it down and push it down and push it down and hope nobody knows. And I remember I was in a spiritual disciplines class at 6:30 in the morning. If you ever go to college, don't ever take a 6:30 in the morning class, all right? It's crazy. But I've got this 8-page paper on my spiritual life, and I lied for 8 pages straight. I'll be honest with you, I lied. I said, I read my Bible every day. I pray twice a day. I do all these things. And I remember 6:30 in the morning, it was my time to present and read my paper to class. And I got up there at a podium like this, and I did this, and all of a sudden, it hit me, and I started to cry. And I threw my paper down, and I said, you might as well fail me because it's a lie. I can't live this lie anymore. I can't fake it anymore. I'm struggling. And for an entire 45 minutes, I just completely confessed that I felt like a loser, and I felt like I was failing at the Christian life. I felt like I didn't have it to, you may all have it together, but I didn't have it together. And for 45 minutes straight, I cried. And then the truth of God showed up. James 5:16 says, confess your faults to one another, pray for one another that you may be healed. Some of us never get healed in life. Some of us never get the grace in life because we're not owning up to the truth of our life. And in that 45 minutes, something miraculous happened. They started crying because they were doing the same thing I was. And they felt the weight of the world on their shoulders to keep up the lie and keep moving forward. And in that moment, we cried together, we prayed together, we talked together, we read the Bible together. And since that moment, I've never looked back. There was healing when I faced truth. There was grace when I faced truth. I remember my first year in ministry, we were at a little old country church. And there was this woman, she was in her 70s, and she did everything. I mean, she did bus ministry, she did prayer ministry, she did women's ministry. She was like the saint of old in the church, and she was always in the back, there like the right section. And I remember she was always there, always faithful. Every time the church was open, anytime we needed something done, she showed up. And I remember at the end of a sermon, I'm standing there, you know, like the altar call workers do, and I got my Bible, and she starts walking down, and she's crying. I'm thinking, what in the world? Something must have happened in her family. She was always praying for evangelism. She was always praying for her friends to get saved. And she's coming down, and she's got tears in her eyes, and she said, I can't live this lie anymore. I'm not a Christian. I don't believe. And I don't know if I'll ever get to heaven. And in that truth, she found grace, because for the next 2 hours, I cried with her. We opened the Bible together. I showed her from Romans chapter 3, verse 23, 6, 23, 5, 8, 10, 9, and 10, 13, 10. We went through the gospel. We read the Bible together. And at the end of that, she got saved. 70 years old, been in the church her whole dang life. She served faithfully, and she wasn't even Christian. She was living a lie. But when she faced up to the truth, she found grace for her soul. I'm telling you, when you own up, there is grace. I remember in high school, there was this family member that we had. I'm going to be careful. There was a family member that we had that was in prison, and she called the house, and everybody was gone. And I answered the phone and said, do you accept the call from such and such prison? And I said, sure, because I knew who it was, and I didn't know if it was something important. And for 30 minutes, she proceeded to tell a high school kid that was 17 years old, who had no clue in the world. She just needed to tell somebody her sins. And I'm thinking, this is the wrong person. Mom didn't answer the phone. Dad didn't answer the phone. This is Nathan. And I could hear the beep in the background, and I knew time was getting short, and I didn't know what to say other than I said, God loves you. And she started to bawl, because in that truth of knowing where you are at, God is willing to meet you where you're at when I was 15 years old. And I could go on and on. This will be the last one, I promise you. When I was 15 years old, my youth pastor, sat at my feet and cried because he got addicted to drugs, ruined his family, ruined the church, and he didn't know who to talk to. And my parents, for whatever crazy reason, allowed him in the house. And he's sitting on my floor, a grown man who had lost everything, not knowing what to say other than crying and say, "Forgive me." And I said, "I can't forgive you, but I know the one who can. And if you're willing to tell him the truth, there is grace for you to meet you where you are. I'm telling you, in the moment of truth, there is healing, there is hope, and there is grace."
Sing we the song of the Christ who was long foretold. Lo, in the shadows of Bethlehem, promise of dawn our eyes behold. God most high in a manger lay. Lift your voices and now proclaim, great and glorious, love has come to us. Join now with the host of heaven.
Oh,